solemnem, tăcie mală ce.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Geomologist Presents. I don't know how long the show will be. It probably will not be long, but I wanted to discuss something that I'm calling a game in your back pocket. You know how it is when we have a game session coming up, we prep for it, and then suddenly it does not make. So I had that instance a couple times last week, since I'm generally record a week in the rears. And last week, there are two games that did not make, so I had to come up with a backup game. So I'm going to talk briefly about those and the value of having a game in your pocket. But first, we got a call-in from Jason Connerly, who has a great anecdote about a murder mystery and how to run one in your RPG. I believe the game that he's going to talk about was run by GM Shadow of the GM Shadow podcast, Barry. And he's changed it to another podcast name. Found it. It is called A Song of Dice and Shadows. So take a gander at his podcast. So without further ado, we'll bring on Jason.
Carry on, my wayward son. There'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest. Don't you cry no more.
Hey, Carl. Jason here. Enjoyed your interview with Kevin Madison. I think the biggest thing that he said there that people should take away is that magic and technology and all these things are just different ways to find clues. And if you've designed the clues correctly, it really doesn't matter how they find them. And I think that is a really important concept. When we did a 10th level, which is the highest level in MERP, unless you add in the Rolemaster stuff, but when we did a 10th level murder mystery using Middle-earth role-playing, that was run by Barry over at former Shadow the GM, now A Song of Dice and Shadows podcast. I was playing a 10th level, magic user in that, or wizard, whatever, in that game. And I was able to cast all these crazy spells, but because he had designed the clues correctly, it didn't break anything having that magic. And we still had to track the clues down and all that. That was a more of an open world kind of thing. It was set in Gondor, but we could go talk to anybody, and he didn't have to resort to telling us, no, concentrate on these suspects. We were able to talk to anybody we wanted to without GM interference, but it worked very well. So I think that advice from Kevin about, just looking at them, not trying to shut magic down, but just accepting it's a different way to uncover clues, because the characters still have to interpret those clues, was a real great nugget, and hopefully that'll help people when they design their own mysteries in whatever genre they decide to run.
Hey, Jason, thank you for that call. Yeah, that's a great piece of advice. Remember, the clue is just a clue, no matter how you get it, and let them get clues from their use of their magic. I think that's an excellent idea. It's a great idea. I think another neat anecdote, and I should have mentioned this when Kevin and I were recording, but in Reaver, right, my character has this ability to speak with spirits, to speak with the dead, and I think Joe Salvador has done a great job of giving us those clues so we can figure out the mystery, and I love his cryptic, we don't always ask the smartest questions, of course, but I do love his cryptic answers, and we get the clue, but now how do we interpret it? And sure, let the players use their magic. The hardest one to me would be reading someone's mind, because you would think that, how are they gonna, but again, it's just a clue, right? It could just give you a face, it could give you a name, but then what do you do with that? I mean, what if it gives you a name? Brian. There's a lot of Brians, right? So, give you a face, but now you gotta find this person. I think that's okay. So I really, as a GM, my advice, Jason's advice, GM Shadow's advice, Kevin's advice is to let the players, give them the agency, let them do their magic stuff, give them a clue, be honest about the clue, and let them figure out the mystery. I think that's a great idea. All right. Again, thank you for that call, Jason. Hey, if you guys want to get involved in the interaction, please drop me a line, gmologist@gmail.com, or on the various Discords. I'm whatever it's called. Is it hashtag? Is it a hashtag? Yeah, hashtag Carl Rodriguez. You can find me on various Discords, the Audio Dungeon Discord, the Gmologist Presents Workshop and Lab, something called like that. I'm on the Dungeon Muser Discord as well. You can track me down, drop me a line. And I have a SpeakPipe account, and you can leave me about a 90-second message through there as well. So, right. So the main topic at hand, as I ramble on here. So Wednesday is Pathfinder Wednesday, and we normally have either Abomination Vault, but that's been on a big hiatus. It seems something always comes up on a Wednesday, and we alternate that with Kingmaker. We were actually able to play a session of Kingmaker, and we're into, I guess, the quote-unquote second book of Kingmaker, although now it's one big book in Pathfinder 2, but they've defeated the Stag Lord and now are starting their little kingdom that they're calling the Riverlands, and they set up the government. They have NPCs and other player characters doing various tasks. We did a domain turn, and the game suggests that you do like a domain turn every month, so 3 weeks of adventuring and then a domain turn, but we did a couple domain turns back to back just to get a feel for it, get them started on their kingdom building. They have a settlement called Shrikeport that is there on this lake called the Tuskwater at the confluence of the Tuskwater and the Shrike River, overlooking the lake on a bluff. So they're able to incorporate the Staglord's Fort and make it their town hall, and they've built some houses. And then we did that domain. It was kind of slow, I would say. And I feel like I've suggested we do that on the Discord, but we'll see how that goes. I do think the players would rather discuss what they want to do and then do the roles like live. So that's probably what's going to happen. But then I suggested again, 3 weeks out in the field, in the wilderness, and then 1 week of domain. And I think they've been doing that. We had a good session. We had several encounters. I'm not going to go into those details because, well, spoilers and stuff. But it was good to get the dice rolling, to have some diplomatic and combat encounters. And I thought they acquitted themselves pretty well, which was kind of neat. But the week before, well, it was supposed to be Abomination Vaults. And again, that has suffered. So we decided at two players, and we were like, well, what do you want to do? We have a couple backup games. Hyperborea, which I would like to push the Hyperborea game, but I don't know. I feel like the players are reluctant. I know one player seems to get dropped every session. Maybe that's part of it. Maybe the adventure is dragged on, maybe because the original mission was done by characters who are now dead, and these are like replacement characters. But I feel like I'd like to finish that adventure and move on to other Hyperborean goodness. But the other game I had in my back pocket was Before the Lost City, which I think is really fun and fantastic. And that was, I think, easier to jump into. I run it on Fantasy Grounds. They have a really good module set. And then you can find fan-made modules. They call them modules for the OSE rule set. And we're using OSE Basic. I do have some house rules, and they did come up. So I have, when someone goes to zero, we do a turn over the body at the end of the combat, and then they roll a saving throw versus death for like a last chance ditch effort to be alive. And then they'll have a permanent disability, possibly or not. They'll have a scar of some sort when you turn the body over. I do have meta currency, the number of player characters we have. They have six rerolls. There's six characters. They have six rerolls during the game. And it just, the reason I do this is I prefer story, And it's always fun to have a second chance. Sometimes second chance doesn't work. I'm just saying, these low-level characters. And actually, the characters we played enough that the cleric is level 2, and the other characters are still level 1, very close to level 2. When they get to level 2, it seems like the survivability increases exponentially, right? And I do the other house rule I have is shields must be sundered, and we didn't recall that house rule, but we have a little house rule notes handout on the game, and one of the players pointed that out. I'm actually playing with BJ Boyd of the Arcane Alias. It's one of the players. He's like, "Oh, we have shields must be sundered," and then so we hadn't played a long time. I let him do that because one of his characters actually dropped, turned over the body, died. But then when they dragged him back, he's like, "Oh, we have shields must be sundered." I go, "Do you have a shield?" He's like, "Yeah, I had a shield." And you could see because he was porting over his inventory to the party. Like, yeah, he has got a shield. So I guess the shield is sundered. And then he wake up. Like with the start, you're knocked unconscious. All these splinters and fragments of shield are in your arm and body. So he's alive. And there we go. But it was really fun to do Lost City. I think we're on... They've cleared the first couple levels and we're on level 3, and that's the quote unquote faction level. I'm spoiling it a little bit because this adventure's been around right since the 80s. So, you know, and it's a fun adventure. I'm using actually what I love. I'm using the original Adventures Revisited. What's from the series, the Ore series by Goodman Games. And I'm using the B4 out of there, but it has the original, both printings, and then it has a 5th edition version that expands greatly on the city dip beneath and the tiers 6 through 10 of the pyramid, which is kind of neat. So you imagine basically a regular pyramid or ziggurat, and then an inverted pyramid or ziggurat, stuck, butt to butt. That's kind of the dungeon there. And there was an outline in the original before of both of those places. The bottom 6 to 10 levels were a little bit fleshed out with the main monster on that level, but it's kind of an outline. And then the Lost City was just, a blurb. Here's a Lost City. Here's a map. Go for it. Which is kind of neat. But I'm glad the 5th edition version has fleshed it out. And if we get to there, I will be using OSE Basic to run that part of the adventure. So, we'll see how it goes. I had a fun time. So we ran through a couple rooms, really, because we had kind of hemmed and hawed and kind of talked about, how gaming groups go. We just talk about nothing. We hemmed and hawed what we wanted to play, and we finally settled on that. So we played for a little bit. And again, even though you would think we've been playing this game forever, it's easy to get back into. Sometimes it's hard to coordinate all that stuff, and it was probably a question of we haven't been to Fantasy Grounds for a while. We have to update it. That took a few minutes. And then we got to figure out where everything is on Fantasy Grounds again. And then play. Once we get to playing, though, it's pretty smooth. So that was the first game in my back pocket before The Lost City. And this reminds me, I know BJ and I did this podcast a few episodes back. MOSR, more OSR in March. And I want to run some OSR games, guys. I really do. I had a great idea. I was looking through Known World stuff, and I think on the Vaults of Pandarius site, they're like, "Oh, these are where all the B modules are located." And it'd be really fun to run a Known Worlds campaign using the B modules, or starting with the B modules, and working my way from there. This is inspired really by TJ Drennan. I blame him for all things OSR. No, that's not true. No, but TJ for the D&D birthday ran some B2, and now I feel like I have a context of where to put it and how to put it in the Known World and do all the politics and stuff like that, and I'd love to do that. The other MOSR things I have in mind are a dual game, solo game, with Amy and I running AD&D 1.5, and we have our character, and we have the idea of where I want to run it in the Moonshades and the Forgotten Realms, and I even have the adventure I want to do. It's just a matter of sitting down and doing it. We probably will do that here in March. As a side note, we do have a lot of content coming up on YouTube, especially our Twilight 2000 campaign that's ongoing. And the most recent one shows a big battle against an armed and armored convoy. The Players Do, the Free Krakow Company Coalition, we kind of calculated, they're like 62 plus strong, and they have one tank and several armored fighting vehicles, and they have a dragon. Well, they have a Hindi. So that definitely unbalances the playing field until they run out of ammo and stuff like that, or someone finds a law or a stinger somewhere, but there probably aren't that very many of them around, or gets lucky with an RPG. But so far so good with them. I think that's been pretty cool. That's on the YouTube channel. You can check it out. I put the link in the show notes. But I'd like to get, I said, like to move OSR, more OSR. And in March, why not? We have an extra day to prep here in February, so why not plan for that? The other thing I'd love to do is either using OSE Advanced, Shadow Dark, or AD&D again, would be to run through the A series. I have a compilation, A0, which is an intro to the Slaver series, and then A1 through 4, which takes place in Greyhawk. I think that would be pretty fun. And actually, now that brings that out and segues into the second back pocket. So we normally play Warhammer Fantasy with the home group. So that was Wednesday, last Wednesday, and then and then the next Thursday, and the group didn't make, a couple of people couldn't do it. So even though, like, when I got there, they're like, oh, we could still play Warhammer Fantasy, right? And I said, yeah, but you guys didn't mention that we can. We could play with three people. It doesn't matter. We played this game for so long. And then we just, you know, pull the people into the shadows or in the background. They're off doing something else. Oh, well. And then I think it really is an unwritten rule that they don't get the XP for being there. And that's kind of what we do. But since two people were out and we had three, that's kind of our rule three. We do another game. We've been doing Octoon Cthulhu, but that wasn't the crew that was there this time. And this time, someone suggested a game called Cyborg, which is Morkborg Cyberpunk. And I've been wanting to run a cyberpunk game with this group. We've thrown around ideas, Carbon 2185, which is a 5th edition hack of a cyberpunk-y tech world, Shadowrun, which we played during the COVID times, but because a lot of the players there just were not comfortable, did not really jive with the Roll20 or the VTT type of platform, so it didn't work so well. So we might get back to Shadowrun, though I would propose maybe using Wetwired as well for a concept that I have. But then also Cyberpunk Red or 2020 has been proposed, especially because one of the players really loves the life path systems when you make characters. He loves to make characters. So, yeah, I guess we have one of those in every gaming group, don't we? I think in another podcast, just as another non sequitur, I might interview my players somewhat, not really interviewing, but, you know, ask the question, what type of player do you think you are, right? Because there's always seems to be a player, you know, the one who loves to make characters. There's always a power gamer. There's always sort of the social gamer. There's the game group clown, right? The guy who's always cheeky and making jokes and the throwing puns left and right. And then there's the guy who collects all the animals. Right, so it'd be really. I was just thinking about my table, my home group's table, and yeah, we have those, we have those. So yeah, it's pretty interesting how that dynamic works and how it works well, because we've been playing here on almost 3 years together, and actually more than that with some of these folks. So pretty cool stuff. Anyway, we played Cyborg, and it was fun because we were able to just, you know, I printed out character sheets. They're very, it's very bright and pink everywhere, pink and yellow everywhere, by the way, in these books, both Morkborg and Cyborg. And I didn't really worry about the background. Hey, let's just play some fun cyberpunky type of game. And they made characters. We rolled them up all randomly at the table. We had three players. And then I ran through the adventure, something about a casino that you've got to find and rescue a guy or get the data from. And it worked pretty well. It was a pretty easy system, right? It's a D20 roll to hit a target number. The characters were not very competent at first level, and they were rolling very poorly. But they actually managed to get out of there with some injuries, a lot of shooting, as you would expect. It was kind of the funnest roll, I think, was when, well, a couple fun things happened, because there's not just, you know, the AI and the virtual reality world, like the web or whatever, the internet or webnet or whatever it's called, but there's also some sort of alien presence in the world, and they manifest sort of magic, but it's more like nanites. Anyway, I think it's also controlled probably by an AI. But anyway, so one of the player characters got some black goo on him, and he failed, but then there's like a mishap table, and the mishap table made him teleport. So he teleported up to this like private poker game. And then he was like, oh my gosh. And he hid. He was able to hide. He rolled really well to hide. And he was just watching the poker game. And then eventually one of the other players was able to get up there, and he met the people who were playing the poker game. And then we rolled, which I love. You know, my favorite table probably in all OSR type games and, you know, all classic games is the reaction table. 2d6, you know low is bad, you know high is really good, and, you know, in the middle, you roll again and you see what happens, right? It's kind of neutral. So we rolled, and the player rolled boxcars, so 12. So I kind of made up the fiction that he knew the leader of the gang. And then I determined that the gang was there for their own mission, and it kind of meshed with the player character's mission. And then we had a really good, fun fight at the end. But I like that cyberpunk thing, you know, with hacking and guns and, you know, sort of the, and of course in Cyborg, you know, it's like Merkborg, so it's kind of mudcore, so like rusty, dirty cyberpunk type of game. Very nihilistic and feel like whatever you do doesn't matter type of thing. But hey, it mattered. They found out that the data was actually a person that was hooked up to the computer, rescued that person. That's who the gang was trying to rescue anyway, as part of their job. They got out there, they got money, they got the vault. The other fun thing that happened too is one of the person kind of found some drugs and took the drugs, and actually it helped him because he had like one hit point anyway that like doubled his hit points, but then went on sort of a murder spree and had to keep rolling every round to see if he got control back. And then he had his quirk that he collected belts, so he was killing people and taking their belts. And then by the end, he had this like cat of nine tails made out of belts that was just whipping around. But eventually he kind of snapped out of it and got away. So I thought that was pretty fun. There's also a fun interlude. I love the quirks too that they develop. There's so many fun random tables, and the players bought into the totally roll randomly for their characters. So I think it was a very enjoyable session. I have a fun group of guys. So there you go. And I think a game like Cyborg, Pirate Borg is like this too, because I played it at the table where you just make up characters and go randomly. And I could have not, I didn't have to have run the sort of lucky casino adventure in there in the book, but I could have just randomly rolled an adventure, which is a possibility. All right, upcoming week is going to be really fun as I kind of come to a close, and encourage you to always have a game in your back pocket. I'm really going to try to make a diligent effort to have a backup game. So I know prep for two games, that's kind of the poll question I'm asking. And if you have a backup game or a favorite backup game, I know games that I feel like I can run spontaneously without too much prep, or like Call of Cthulhu, Savage Worlds, any of these Borg games, it seems I could do that just off the cuff. For sure, Octoon Cthulhu, probably I would need a little more prep time on some of the other 2D20 games, but Cohorse Cthulhu could also be that way. So think about those games. Think about your favorite easy system to come up with. Oh, I think I can also run like BX spontaneously, because it doesn't take long to make a character, really. And that was the other thing that I proposed some sword and wizardry, to try to run, because we could make characters very quickly and then run an adventure. But the player characters chose Cyborg, so there you go. So maybe for the next back pocket game, I will bring the swords and wizardry box with me, and say, hey, we're gonna play this because it's March and we need more OSR. So in any case, up on the YouTube channel coming up, so the latest Twilight 2000 is up, the attack on the big convoy that I mentioned. We have a sort of side quest that's coming up premiering tonight, the Tunnel Mission, which was a mission that was conceived way back during the Pirates of the Vistula. The Free Caracal Coalition had run across the Marines, had turned them, rescued them from the Admiral, and they said, well, we got prisoners. The Baron's holding prisoners against us. If you can help rescue the prisoners, I know we can recruit more of the Baron's men to our side. And they finally did the Tunnel Mission. And I kudos to Amy because she actually did the research. And there are extensive tunnels dating back to World War II in Warsaw. And they were expanded during World War II, first by during the Warsaw Revolution, Warsaw Uprising during that time, used by the people in Warsaw then, and then later by the Soviets and Polish during the Cold War, and the KGB used them extensively. And there's like maps and people explore them on YouTube. So kudos to Amy for doing that research. And actually, I guess the way I did it, and you'll see, and I explain it on the YouTube channel, but I'll explain it here for you guys who don't like actual play. So everything I rolled was like random, right? So I was thinking, well, I mean, these tunnels probably have been not seen use, but they're pretty well reinforced, and they've been created to withstand like nuclear blasts, like ground nuclear blasts. And in the Twilight 2000 world, Warsaw was bombed, but mostly like air bursts and then a lot of fires and stuff like that. So then I had an idea of what could be down there, and I looked at the random encounter chart, and it really worked for my idea of if tunnels could be collapsed, etc. What you find down there, would you find like underground people, swarms of rats, you know? And then in the book, Ruins of Warsaw, there is no mention of the Baron knowing about these tunnels, though these tunnels were known about during the 80s when this book was made. So my idea was, well, if I roll a patrol, which suggests that it's one of the Baron's men, then the Baron learned about the tunnels or discovered them. But that never happened, and you'll see in the Tunnel Mission, which premieres, like I said, tonight or today, because this comes out at the same time. And then we also were able to run Coyote and Crow, and there's an awesome cast of people that's run by BJ Boyd of the Arcane Alienist, and that's coming up next week, Monday. And then the second part of the attack on the convoy and the planning for the final assault on the Black Baron in Warsaw will premiere next week. So that's what's going on in the YouTubes. Check out our YouTube channel again. Actual play is not for everyone, but you can fast forward and at least maybe look through, at least like and subscribe. That would be great. Like and subscribe and check it out if you want. We're not voice actors or professionals. Amy does her Kasha voice, but that's the extent of it, I think. Although I think in the Savage Worlds Deadlands game, I do Western voices because it's easy and it's fun. So anyway, I think that is all. 25 minutes of just ramble on, huh? So without further comment, I will just say that thank you again to Jason Connerly for the call-in. Thank you again, my listeners. Thank you, TJ Drennan, for the intro and outro music. And thank you, Amy, for always being willing to test various games and for the cover clip art. And without any more of me, good night and good rolling.